Yeah. Good morning and welcome to this summer school. So today is actually the first day of the trimester. So the title of this trimester is Types, Sets and Constructions. And right now I remember vividly how the whole thing started. There was an event in Hamburg in 2015 and a meeting of the German Mathematical Society. And one day, Peter Schuster and Josef Petrakis approached me and they said they wanted to talk to me. And I think we went to a cafe and they told me about the idea of having a trimester on type theory and constructivism at the Hausdorff Institute. And I replied, okay, that's a great idea, but what's my role in this? And so they said, well, you know the director. It was the previous director. But the outcome had nothing to do with the director. I mean, it's externally evaluated. So that's right, so we just won this competition. And so this was 3 years ago, basically, when this started, and now it's happening. So I'm glad it's happening now. And great. So today, first day of summer school, so this will be about tutorials, different, the whole week. Actually, it will spread over into the next week. The whole summer school will be highlighting all the topics of this trimester. And yeah, so the first real talk will start in about an hour's time. So I'm standing here because I think it was foolish that I didn't say no. So Peter Schuster sent me an email and asked whether I could give an introduction or something like that. And it was about also, okay, so welcoming you, of course, but then there's also the issue of, he said that I could give maybe give some talk about the history or the context and so on. And so foolishly I said yes. And I think it's not a good idea to give a talk about the history, because usually what you do, you rush through the history and nobody will remember anything afterwards. And so the lecturers, the tutorial lecturers, have a much better way of explaining things, and I don't want to anticipate this. So boring talk is the worst thing that can happen. Okay, and then I think I had a conversation, my memory might play tricks on me, but I think Peter also said a conversation that on the phone that I could talk about God and the world. And I thought that this is a much better idea. Okay, so let me talk a little bit about God and the world, And maybe it relates to something of the, somehow to the trimester. Let's see. Okay. So first we unhide this. So the title is Sets, Constructions, and Some Field Math. So for the last, I don't know how many years, 5 years or so, I have been giving a course in philosophy of mathematics together with a philosopher at the University of Leeds. And if you look at the philosophy of mathematics, there are lots of isms. So there's the more familiar ones like Platonism, logicism, formalism that we, intuitionism we all know about. And there are other things like, so basically, by the way, our course starts with Kant. Mathematics is synthetic a priori. Kant is quite interesting and actually will recur all the time as you go through the philosophy of mathematics as it developed in the 19th and then 20th century, and now the 21st. But there are also other, you see other isms like nominalism, which from the medieval ages, and that, for instance, is reflected in the fictionalism here, which, I don't know if you know the names, but for instance, Hartree Fields is a big figure in this area. And this has stirred up a lot of excitement in philosophy of mathematics. But there's almost no connection to mathematical logic. So people in mathematical logic, I think, usually don't know much about that. I think in philosophy, philosophy to some extent is also driven by certain trends or fashion. And right now, the question is with fictionalism and these things and with neologicism, and right now, constructivism is not so popular, but this might change. Anyway, so we have all these isms in the philosophy of mathematics. There's also one thing I think is missing in the philosophy of mathematics, and it's very often the view, they kind of go over, they mull over the same arguments again and again. And it's, to a large extent, it's a very introspective enterprise. I think there's something missing. It has to be linked with a larger story, and this is the story, where do we come from? Okay, where do we come from? Well, there is, in particular, where do we come from, and why are we good at doing mathematics? That's the question. Okay, so the Abrahamic religions that trace themselves back to Abraham, they have an easy way of explaining this. So God created man in his own image. There's this famous painting by Michelangelo. Okay, so God is good at mathematics, so we are good at mathematics. That's an easy explanation. In other religions, there are many gods, and they are not much better than us. Or there are also religions where the gods or the creators or the demiurgs or demiurge, as they say in English, where they are of animal kind. And so there we do not have necessarily a real cleavage between humans and the rest of the natural world, the animals. Okay, and the theory that we are related to the rest of the world, well, one of the people who thought so was Lamarck in 1809, and then we all know the story about evolution, Darwin, 1859, he was prompted to publish this because Wallace had published something similar a year ago. And so this was a very lively time. Of course, the theory of evolution has its own problems. At the time when Darwin and Wallace and also Lamarck proposed this theory, there was a certain evidence, but there was also a lot of evidence against it, and it was very hard to explain how evolution worked. So a first step was done by Mendel in his experiments with peas. So he found some rules how heredity is kind of is passed from generations of in living things. And well, at the time, I think it's fair to say that Darwin and Wallace didn't know anything about this mechanism. That this was a hotly debated thing. I mean, you might remember there was a famous meeting in 1860 at the British Society of the Advancement of Science, where Huxley, a friend of Darwin, spoke, and his counterpart, I mean, the foe basically was the Bishop of Oxford, Wilberforce, and they had this very nice exchange, which I think is a great piece of rhetoric. So Huxley was kind of making the case for evolution. And then Wilberforce asked Huxley whether he had a preference for the descent being on the father's or the mother's side, and because we descended from a gorilla. So the question is, which side would you prefer, your mother or your father being descending from an ape? And of course, this was a great move to kind of say basically that the whole theory of evolution was rubbish. And then Huxley famously replied that he would sooner claim kindred with an ape than with a man like the bishop. Okay, so this debate, how does evolution work? Actually, you need a lot of time for this. So one of the crucial question was, how long did it take, and how much time did we have? So in 1897, Thomson, later Lord Kelvin, calculated the age of the Earth. And he calculated it was just 20 to 40 million years old. And that is not very much in terms of evolution, if you just tiny steps lead to a lot of tiny steps lead to new species. But only 10 years later, Rutherford calculated the age with in a different way. Radioactivity was a new thing, and he calculated 4.5 billion years, and that's that much more time for evolution. Still, the question is that enough? Okay, the larger picture. So the humans, why humans are good at mathematics? So so there's a theory about the humans, how they arose and how they developed as part of the natural world. And so we have this, the human and chimpanzee split is usually located somewhere between 5 and 7 million years ago. And then Homo habilis, one of the ancestors, they used 2 million years ago, used stone tools. And it was thought that Homo erectus spread from Africa across the old world about 1.5 or 2 million years ago. And what was very important was that Homo erectus controlled fire. Fire, because with fire you can change the landscape. And okay, and modern humans are supposed to have arisen around 200 to 300,000 years ago. And this also came with an increase in brain size and brain power. So humans must have acquired at some point the ability of symbolic thinking. And so some theories say this sort of language and the capacity for mathematical thinking came for free with offline thinking. So offline thinking means that you not only make plans in front of certain objects. Maybe if a banana is dangling from the ceiling, a chimpanzee will know how to get to it. But it's about thinking about the world without having any sensory input. So that's sometimes called offline thinking. By the way, I should say that this kind of picture, so the history of mankind and how it evolved, that is a theory which changes all the time. So very, very different from mathematics. So if I would compare this to something that children do, it's like at a certain age, children are able to connect dots, and then you see some kind of figure or some object, right? If you were to add more dots, you would see a different figure. And this is what happens in this area all the time. So usually it's based on what they find in certain caves. And of course now we have very powerful tools like DNA analysis. And then they basically extrapolate from what they know. But as soon as they find something else, the whole picture changes. So in recent years, a lot of changes have arisen. So now, for instance, also the Neanderthals are thought to have played a role, and there's another group of people, the Denisovans, they found some remains, some skulls and bones in the Altai Mountains. And now from DNA analysis, we know that also these populations have contributed to modern humans. And so maybe the split between Neanderthals and humans is something that's debated. So some people think it was 500,000 years ago. So anyway, this kind of science is very different from mathematics. Anyway, so about mathematics, so language, maybe the capacity for offline thinking and language brought about the ability to do mathematics. But we should remember that humans didn't have much use for mathematics until very recently. So usually when we talk about history, we talk about the Romans. But from a larger point of view, the Romans are not very relevant. What's really relevant is that until quite recently, we all were hunter-gatherers. And only in the Holocene, with the new period, which started 12,000 years ago, we have domestication of plants and animals, agriculture, and animal husbandry. That changed a lot. And so And after that, we have larger societies where mathematics could play a role and was useful. But the capacity for our capacity for doing mathematics seems to be much, much older. Okay. Okay, so all these kind of philosophies of math, they never talk about this stuff, but I think it's relevant. I should say maybe that there are some people who have said something about this. For instance, the Kantian synthetic a priori. So Konrad Lorenz, I think in the 1940s, made a connection with Kant and evolution, so that maybe evolution honed our brains in a certain way. And these brains are capable of doing mathematics, but this could also explain why mathematics is applicable to the world, because somehow our brains were molded to be useful in this world. Okay, we still have some time, I see. Great. All right. So mathematics is an amazing thing. So humans live in a middle world, and we have no intuitive grasp of very small and very large things and very long periods of time. For instance, long periods of time. I mean, so if you think that, for instance, maybe just 100 people made it from Asia crossing the Bering Strait going to America, to the Americas, how long would it take to fill the Americas with people, say, from the very north to the very south? You just start with 100 people. Well, it turns out it just takes 1,000 years to fill the Americas with 10 million people, and then you have a population which is sustainable from a hunter-gatherer point of view. And you just need a population increase of 1.4% per year to achieve this. It's a long process, so we have no imagination of that. Just 100 people, you would think this is nothing. But it is. Okay, physics and mathematics. There's these nice quotes we all know from Galileo, the book of nature is written in mathematics. Einstein, he wrote a letter, of course, in German in 1921, and he kind of reiterated this point. An enigma presents itself, which in all ages has agitated inquiring minds. How can it be that mathematics, being after all a product of human thought, which is independent of experience, is so admirably appropriate to the objects of reality? Is human reason then, without experience, merely by taking thought, able to fathom the properties of the real things? And okay, so mathematics is extremely useful in physics. So for instance, one example that's always quoted is the prediction in quantum electrodynamics. The errors now between predictions and measurements are very, very small. Okay, so now mathematics are very different. Mathematics are a different science than physics and chemistry, we know that. And sometimes, from a philosophical point of view, it's very hard to say what it's about. And what is also very unique about it is this high degree of rigor, which is, in particular, it's not like many sciences like anthropology. So where, by adding new information, we basically destroy the old picture. In mathematics, the Cauchy integral formula is still valid. Yeah. So additional knowledge doesn't destroy previous knowledge or the picture. So that's very unique. Okay, now let's go back to philosophy of mathematics. So here, this is another well-known painting by Raphael of the School of Athens. From your point of view, on the left-hand side we have Plato. On the right-hand side we have Aristotle. And so Plato is associated with Platonism, and there's some justification for that. So this is a quote from the Republic. So it's about mathematics, actually about geometry. So he talks about geometry, and he says there's something strange about it, namely the language that these geometers use is somewhat ludicrous, for they speak as if they were doing something, and as if all their words were directed towards action. For all their talk is of squaring and applying and adding and the like, whereas in fact the real object, of the entire study is the knowledge of that which always is, and not of something which at some time comes into being and passes away. For geometry is the knowledge of the eternally existent. So this is really what Platonism is about. It's about the argument is it's some realm. So it's a story about some realm, some myth about some realm where these objects exist and where the mathematical facts are determined. For one of the problems with this kind of philosophy of mathematics is the access problem. We as humans do not have access to this world. For Plato, it's not a problem because he had this theory about the soul that had visited this place before. So again, it's rather some kind of theological explanation that he gives. Aristotle, on the other hand, so the one thing that has exercised modern mathematics and created problems is infinity. And okay, so for Plato, infinity is apparently not a problem, but for Aristotle only accepted the potential infinite. And so here's a quote from physics. For generally, the infinite has this mode of existence. One thing is always being taken after another. And each thing that is taken is always finite, but always different. So it's always finite. So, okay, and this kind of view of the potential infinite was actually held by many mathematicians until very recently. So, I mean, Gauss in 1831 said something to the effect that I protest against the use of infinite magnitude as something completed, which is never permissible in mathematics. Of course, you might scour now Gauss's work, and maybe there's something where this is not true, where he contradicts himself in a certain sense, practically. Okay, and then we have Cantor in 1883, and of course we have somebody else before that, Bolzano, who embraced the actual infinite before Cantor. Okay, now we're coming to the debate of the foundations of mathematics. So here's a quote from Weil. That's true. So he asked the question, is there a natural number with a certain decidable property? And how do you go about this problem? And he says, only the finding that has actually occurred of a determinate number with the property P can give a justification for the answer yes. And since I cannot run a test through all numbers, only the insight that it lies in the essence of number, that's important, that it lies in the essence of number to have the property not P can give a justification for the answer no. And then comes something quite enigmatic. He says, even for God, we are back to God, even for God, no other ground for decision is available. But these two possibilities do not stand to one another as assertion and negation. So the law of the true admittal is not accepted by Weil. That's from the paper Über die neue Grundlagenkrise from 21. Okay. It's always true that there's a new version available. So what is truth in mathematics? So this is a question that was broached by Weil here. Well, we know an existential quantification is made true by exhibiting the witness or by showing a method how to get this witness. What renders a universally quantified statement true? So classically, So classically, the idea is usually that it's made true by all the instances. So it's like talking about like all the tigers in a certain jungle are infested by a certain parasite.
And basically, you prove this by looking at, investigating every tiger. Okay, so that's the idea of how universally quantified statements are rendered true by going through all the instances. But according to potentialism, so if we, for instance, talk about a realm of objects that's only potentially, that only exists potentially, then you cannot go through all these instances. And in a recent paper by Linnabo and Shapiro, they call such a predicate over a domain, P over domain A, traversable, if classical quantification restricted to A with respect to P is available. So in other words, you interpret the universally quantified statement for all X in A, PX, as yeah, that for each of the instances, this is true, you can. And so to connect this with Weyl's quote, so Weyl thinks this is impossible. If this is an infinite collection or potentially infinite collection, you cannot go through all the instances. So you can only argue by some principle where you invoke the essence of the things that belong to A, so how they are created, for instance, like the induction principle. And to handle non-traversability, a potentialist requires a non-instance-based conception of universal quantification. Okay, now I will just connect this, I think I still have time, with some recent discussions. Is it true it's only 10:57? Okay, so I have time. Well, maybe. Okay, so the continuum. Let's maybe look at the continuum hypothesis. Okay, so take one of the versions you know. So one says that, okay, if you have a subset of the reals, it's either in one-one correspondence, and it's infinite, it's either in one-one correspondence with the naturals or with the entire collection of reals. Okay, and then, so as you know, this is a famous problem that Hilbert put on the, of Cantor's, put on the famous list. And I don't know whether this is well known, but Hilbert proved the continuum hypothesis in the paper Über das Unendliche, on the Infinite, from 1925. This is usually the part that nobody reads. So, in an appendix, or Hilbert sketched a proof of CH. Okay, so what is this proof about? Well, instead of the reals, he uses the bare space, but that's not a big deal. So he looks at all the functions from end to end. And if you read this proof, one thing that this is historically is very strange is that there was almost no reaction, as far as I know, from the mathematical community. Regarding this proof. Okay, so when you go through the proof, I mean, the proof is not really a formal proof, it's a kind of very sketchy, but there is one thing, there's one crucial section, paragraph, where he makes a crucial move, and so this is in German, so this is the English translation. So if we talk now about bare space, about functions from end to end. If we want to order the set of these functions in the way required by the problem of the continuum, we must consider how an individual function is generated. So he has this notion of generating. So this is kind of, I think it's interesting. I'm not a historian, I haven't read all, I've read many papers, but not all of them. So Hilbert makes an assumption that in some sense, these mathematical objects, the functions from Gauss, that they are generated in some way, yeah? Which is not how we view it these days, yeah? And, well, I think this is the crucial part of the proof.
And I think there was one person who said this kind of proof mainly fell into the void. There was no reaction. But there was one person, I think, who carefully read this, and this was Gödel. And I think that's the idea of the constructible universe somewhere here. Okay. So this continuum of this is still, at least a couple of years ago, there was a very heated debate about it. And you would think, basically, the work by Cohen and Gödel had answered this question satisfactorily. But there was still a big debate a couple of years ago. So it erupted like a volcano that had been dormant for a long time. And then there was a very heated discussion, in particular on form. Okay, now let's look at maybe a dream solution first. So this is a template that was, that's what used by Joel Hamkins. But it's kind of nice to make the point. So what would be a dream solution for determining the truth of some set theoretic statement in V, in the set theoretic universe? For instance, CH. Well, the dream solution would be, well, we know that, of course, it's not deducible from ZF or ZFC, but maybe we just forgot some axioms that are just two, that we haven't added to the axioms of ZFC. So this would be the ideal solution. So we produce a set theoretic assertion phi expressing a natural and intuitively true set theoretic principle. And then step two would be, well, it turns out that this phi, this natural principle, either entails CH or its negation. And then we are done, And, okay, so the question is, can we find such statements phi? And there have been several responses. So one is, one view expressed by Wood, and it's a more involved thing, so I will only give you a very, very rough description of it. So Wood has, by now it's already also a long time ago, but he published his papers in The Intelligencer, for instance, about solving the CH problem in some way. Not just saying, okay, there are models that satisfy CH, and there are models where CH is refuted, but he, in some sense, that it's reasonable, the question is still reasonable to find out the truth value of CH in some sense. Okay, that's the, I call it the universe view here. So there's some universe, maybe some preferred universe, which decides CH. On the other hand, Hamkins thinks that there is no question about CH anymore. All the facts are known. We just know that there are different universes and they settle CH in different ways. Yeah. So all of these for Hamkins, all of these, as far as I understand, all of these universes exist as like as a multiverse view. They all exist. They're all equally valid, and CH just flip flops as to its truth value between these universes. And then the debate, somehow the debate was also stirred up by Saul Fevermann. Basically, Fevermann's position is that CH is neither a definite mathematical problem nor a definite logical problem. Okay, and I will explore a little bit these positions here, and in particular the last one. Okay, so Gödel I think there were times when Gödel thought there was this kind of this dream solution was possible, and he had different takes on it. So there's what's sometimes called the intrinsic program. The intrinsic program is that basically we should add more natural axioms to ZFC, and then we will eventually solve CH. So he says here, and this is from 64, that there are still further axioms to be found. And so these axioms should be axioms that in some sense are intuitively true. And he mentions the existence of inaccessible Amaro cardinals. and says that these axioms clearly show that not only that the axiomatic system of Setsuri is incomplete, but also that it can be supplemented without arbitrariness by new axioms, which only unfold the content of the concept of set, as explained above. So the concept was that of the phenomenon hierarchy, I suppose, or the existence of further iterations of certain natural operations. So intrinsic, this would give these axioms an intrinsic necessary status. Well, the hope was for this intrinsic problem was somewhat, many people say it kind of was shattered by forcing, for instance. But basically, all of these axioms do not determine CH in any way, because with forcing extensions you can basically choose the answer. You get different models. Okay, then there's something called the extrinsic program. So here, the intrinsic program, I see still the axioms need to be in some sense intuitively true or somewhat justifiable. The extrinsic program reverts the order of justification. So basically here the justification comes from the nice consequences. And that's sometimes called the extrinsic program. And so this is the famous quote from 47, there might exist axioms so abundant in the verifiable consequences, shedding so much light upon a whole discipline, that quite irrespective of their intrinsic necessity, they would have to be assumed in the same sense as any well-established physical theory. So like a physical theory, so the experiments here would be that we have these nice consequences, I suppose. Okay, so just going back to Woodens. Woodens had this idea of that there should be a kind of a preferable universe where CH is decided. And so he had this big book, which appeared in the 20th century, but there's a second edition in the 21st century. And so basically he changes also his view. From the first edition to the second edition, the view has changed. So he says, ultimately, of far more significance for this book is that recent results concerning the inner model program undermine the philosophical framework for this entire work. So he kind of rescinds his the philosophical view of the first volume. And in the first volume, the evidence favored not CH. That was a preferred model that the idea was to work towards a model where CH is invalidated, but now he says, I think the evidence now favors CH. And the picture that is emerging now is as follows: the solution to the inner model problem for one supercompact cardinal yields the ultimate enlargement of L, and this enlargement of L is compatible with, and so on and so on. So this is an ideal world in some sense. But interesting here, so we have this change. Yeah. So it was CH, not CH in the first edition, in the second, the picture has changed. So it's that's kind of interesting, I think. Okay, Pfefferman on CH said, Peter Kerner had a Templeton project exploring the frontiers of incompleteness. And so there was a conference in Boston where he spoke, and so the title was, Is the Continuum Hypothesis a Definite Mathematical Problem? And his analysis is, he wants to distinguish between definite and indefinite. I still have some time to write. Between definite and indefinite problems, mathematical problems. Okay, so there's a notion of definite totality or domain of things, and there's a notion of definite proposition and definite predicate. And in logical terms, they explain as follows. A predicate P, if we look at it over domain D, we say it's definite if the principle of bivalence, or excluded middle holds for it. That is, for all x and d, we have px or not px.
So he links definiteness with bivalence.
And a totality, so this is a predicate over a domain D being definite, and a totality, the realm of object, is definite if quantification over D is a definite logical operation, namely if you have a definite predicate over D, and then you look at the new predicate obtained by quantification over D, it's still definite. So preservation of definiteness is what defines a definite totality. And then he proposed a logical framework for studying such questions. And very roughly he said, so that you cannot miss his slogan, what's definite is the domain of classical logic, and what's not is that of intuitionistic logic. And of course this conference here on types and sets and constructions, intuitionistic logic is kind of the underlying current of this. Okay, and he had some proposals, studying this in a more formal way, by kind of writing down axioms for theories, and then, okay, and then have different logics for different parts of the theory. Okay, so maybe some examples from the history to illustrate this. Well, if you... According to the finitists or ultra-finitists, the natural numbers form an unfinished or indefinite totality, and therefore quantification over the natural numbers is indefinite. So if you have a quantified ranging over all natural numbers, from that point of view, it would be it would lead to an indefinite property. If you are more generous, if you allow the natural numbers to be fully, as a fully formed definite totality, but not much above that, you get the predicativist point of view. More examples, well, for instance, kind of the study of sets of reals at the beginning of the 20th century. So some of these descriptive set theorists, they viewed the reals as a definite totality, but not the power set of the reals. So then you get a view where you can you have quantification over the reals is just to be considered to be definite, but quantification over all subsets of the reals is not. So you can study what such a theory would give you. And in set theory, well, you can also make this distinction. You can say, okay, in set theory, I can say maybe the power set of a set. I consider a set as something definite, and then I also accept the power set operation, meaning that from a set X, I get another set, the power set of X, which then exists fully formed as a definite totality. And then you can still ask, from this point of view, if I accept power set, what do I get? Yeah? How much of set theory, for how much of set theory would I get excluded middle? You could call this power predicative set theory. Okay, it turns out that Solferman doesn't make this connection, but there is a connection to some work by Michael Dummett. And for Dummett, it's about indefinitely extensible concepts. So Michael Dummett is famous for his argument that on meaning theoretic grounds, namely on language theoretic grounds, to explain the functioning of language, the proper logic is intuitionistic logic, not classical logic. And so he's famous for this argument. So this is his famous argument for intuitionism. This is also interesting to contrast that with Brouwer's view. Brouwer's view was rather a solipsistic view. Yeah? So it was this ideal mathematician who was doing their mathematics. But for Dummett did a different justification. His justification for intuitionism is based on more intersubjective grounds. Anyway, there's also another argument, the second argument that he used for saying that in general the intuitionistic logic is the right logic. And this is the
So Frege famously said, I assume that it is known what the extension of a concept is. And basically, this somehow caused all the problems for Frege, the inconsistency of the system. And this is what, at least this is what Dummett's diagnosis of the failure of Frege's project is. So he says it's based on classical quantification. Okay, whatever. So Dummett argued that classical quantification is a legitimate when the domain of investigation is given by an indefinitely extensible concept. And so in, even as late as 94, in What is Mathematics About, he wrote, Cantor saw far more deeply into the matter than Frege. Namely that you cannot simply assume that every concept has an extension as a determinate cardinality. Okay, and something similar here. This, of course, to some extent, harks back to Russell. So here's the only place in this talk where I talk about types. So Russell, suggested the type theory as a remedy for the ailments, for the paradoxes. So Russell in 1906 clearly identified what the problem is. So for the paradoxes, results from the fact that there are what we may call self-reproductive processes and classes. That is, there are some properties such that given any class of terms all having such a property, we can always define a new term also having the property in question. And hence, we can never collect all of the terms having the said property into a whole. Because whenever we hope we have them all, the collection which we have immediately proceeds to generate a new term also having that said property. Okay, so Dummett in 1904, he summarizes that, okay, it is allowed to have quantification over indefinitely extensible concepts or domains, but when you do that, you have to obey the laws of intuitionistic logic. So such a reasoning about an indefinitely extensible domain of objects has to be regimented by intuitionistic logic. And only for the definite parts you're allowed to use classical logic. Okay. You can also view this definitely indefinite extensible versus a definite totality in terms of a language which Parsons called, what we do is when we can talk about extending and creating, it has this kind of human touch, that humans do something, yeah, that we have action. This is what Plato objected against. And so Parsons said, you can also phrase it in a different way, in a certain bloodless, as he called it, bloodless language. We no longer talk about action, but you talk about actual and potential in a more modal way. So the distinction between the actual and the potential goes back to Aristotle. And also here, this is something that has come up in philosophy of mathematics more recently, you could also reserve different logics for the different parts, namely that for the actual parts you have classical logic, and for the potential you only allow intuitionistic logic. Okay. This approach has been tried also by other people, for instance by Tate on reflection principles. And so this was also, and this is also Feverman's suggestion to have a semi-intuitionistic set theory. Okay. I will go very roughly through this. So just a rough sketch of this kind of set theory that Feverman suggested. So you will learn more about constructive set theory from Peter Axel's tutorial. So one thing is that if you wanted to comprehension is a crucial thing in or separation is a crucial thing in set theory, and you only allow comprehension for formulas where the quantifiers are restricted. They're bounded quantifiers. So they arrange over something actual.
And so this is one crucial change in the axioms here. Quantification of the whole set-theoretic universe as a potential domain is still allowed, but the because you can state some generic properties, like if you have a set, you can also create this X, you can create the singleton set with just X in it. Yeah. So you can say something about the whole universe, and the universe has certain properties, but when you do this, you're only allowed to use intuitionistic logic. So it has to be governed by intuitionistic logic. Okay, so this is the theory that Sol Pfefferman suggested for studying this. It's it has lots of the usual axioms. It has also the epsilon induction, infinity pairing, extensionality, and so on. I just rushed through it. Actually, we only have for bounded formulas, where all the quantifiers are bounded to sets. But you also have a surprisingly strong principle this here. So if you read this principle, this is a kind of a marriage of the axiom of choice with the full collection principle. Classically, you would get full separation from this. But I don't want to explain all the details, so let me just press on. Why these axioms, to some extent, they have older roots. They already appear in Meihel's, some of them appear in Meihel's constructive set theory. Why these axioms return also up? There's also some kind of more pragmatic reason why Sol Pfefferman favored these axioms, because you get a functional interpretation from them, similar to Gödel's dialectica. And then Pfefferman's conjecture was that CH is not a definite mathematical problem with respect to the following theory, where you have this underlying basic theory SCS, but you also add, well, if you want to discuss the continuum hypothesis, you better have. You better make the Riedels a set. Yeah, if it's not a set, then this kind of is a moot question. Okay, so if you discuss CH in this context here, SCS plus R is a set, you can view as the context maybe where you can work as a descriptive set theorist, as I described them earlier. So like people like Borel and so on, they might favor such a framework. And then the formal conjecture was that, that CH or not CH is not deducible. So the determinant as a proposition is that you have excluded middle for it. This was the conjecture. I don't want to talk about that. And the conjecture is true. You can also do similar things now with stronger theories, for instance. You have the full power set available, and then you also get similar results to this here. That, for instance, if you take the full power set as an additional axiom, if you add this to the series SCS, then you would, for instance, then you can prove that, for instance, the statement V equals L is not determined. Anyway, I would like to close very soon. So the conjecture is true, the proof requires interesting techniques that we have that feature in constructivism anyway, like realizability interpretation, but also forcing plays a role there. Peter Kerner and Wooden also had an example where there is a statement that is not determinate with respect to SCS plus, so this theory SCS plus the Riedels from a set, and it's the statement Dwar. So Dwar says basically that there is a well ordering of the Riedels in L of R. So L of R is this is in this community of say set theorists. This L of R is kind of a structure where you would like to have the axiom of determinacy to be true. So you cannot have the axiom of choice in it, because if and you cannot well order the Riedels in it, because if you can well order the Riedels, then you well and you can well order the whole universe. So it turns out that that the statement Dwar is not determinate with respect to SCS plus, and so they say this is in conflict with the. With the community of people who work in this area. Anyway,
I have talked enough, I suppose. Oh, yeah. Okay, thank you very much. This is just an introduction.